in there. Woo!
Good morning, New Hope. Oh, it's great to have you guys here today. You know, we have experienced as a community of faith a lot of sickness, a lot of difficulty, some death, and some loss these last number of weeks. And so as we jump in today to this message, I just want to start, you know, we really want to ultimately be thinking about the throne room of heaven, right, where we actually get to approach and talk to and hear from God. And so I just want to say some names out loud because I think it matters. And again, there's just been a lot of this. Christy and Lonnie Berkshire had a baby that was born very premature and didn't make it. They lost baby Presley a number of weeks ago. A few weeks back, Tim Hickey passed away. Remember Carla and her kids, that family. Shelly Davis's brother passed away a couple weeks ago. Wilford Forrest Morrison Jr. He went by Junior, so you don't have to remember that whole name. You can just remember Junior and think about and pray for Shelly and for Junior's kids. Just this last week, Angie Dawson's dad, Harrison Murphy, passed away. Sat right over there in the first gathering. Also on the same day, Francis Bird passed away. Remember the Dawson family. Remember Cheryl and her family as well. As Bethany often says when things like this happen, I just think it's such a good reminder, right? It's especially for people of faith, good for them, bad for us. And so for every one of them, they had faith. They believed in Jesus Christ. They knew Jesus in a way that changed them here and forever. And so what they are experiencing today, we know this, right? They actually have more and better life now than they ever had here on this planet. And that's a good reminder. And so maybe that helps a little bit, but there's still been a lot of loss. And so, Jesus, today, as we approach your throne, we want to remember these people who, for many of us, we knew well, we loved. We have memories and thoughts and experiences and life we shared with these people. Jesus, I just pray that you would comfort us in these days, as again, we think about family members who have been sick or struggling, we think about these losses. Jesus, help us to remember when there's sickness and death, these are your kids too, not just our family and friends. And so, Jesus, I just pray that your life would invade our minds and our hearts and our lives today. We ask these things together in Jesus' name. Amen. I also want to give you guys an update. I've been doing this every week, and it's cool, right? Like, we had $1.1 million in debt 5 years ago, all mortgage debt. We got down after a three-year campaign we did called Building Together, and so many of you were consistent and faithful and generous. We got down to about $550,000, which was great, right, after that three-year campaign. And as of a few months ago, we were at $385,000. But we sold a facility that we owned in Millersburg. That got us down to $85,000. We put some more with that. That got us down to $70,000. And we've been pushing the last 6 weeks or so to retire that, right? To possibly by our annual meeting that takes place at the end of January, so we can spend less money on mortgages and buildings and more money on ministry, right? Like, that's a good thing, right? And I've been saying this, I'm going to keep saying it, like, zero pressure, all opportunity. But, you know, if you've participated, if you haven't participated, if you don't want to participate, again, that's fine. But would you pray? And would you prayerfully sort of ask God, consider what he might be asking you to do as part of this? So I want to give you an update. So we had that last $70,000, you know, that we started with at the beginning of November. As of today, we are at $40,685. I think that's pretty cool. to think of like a couple months ago, 385, today, 40. I really wanted that number this morning to start with a 3, but you know, I mean, that's okay. We'll get there next week. And we want to do this, right, so we can multiply more spaces where people can come just as they are, encounter Jesus, and leave different. Why do we want to do this? We want to do this because we know people. There's people we live by. There are people in our communities and the places we work who are far from God, and they need a safe place and safe people they can be around, right, who will love them and help them to see Jesus. So we do this for people who are far from God. We don't do it for us. I say it all the time. We love that kids are in our spaces and in our halls all the time messing things up, right? And if we ever decide to become one of those churches that makes our space really, really nice and then keeps the community and the kids and the world out so we can keep it nicer for longer, I'm going to quit, right? Like, we are going to give the space away and we're going to use it up, and we are going to be faithful to figure out how to sort of update it and replenish it, right? So we can keep giving it away, because there are people who need to know Jesus and there's people who need to care about that. Good. That's good. Thank you. You guys are like, all right. So we do it for those who are far from God. We also do it for those who are no longer with us and for those who have come before us. I already said this, but I want to say it a little differently. The people who we know and love who aren't here anymore, and maybe that, you know, has been for a while, or maybe that has been, as we said just recently, listen, they are more convinced than ever how important this is, right? Like, they have seen the goal, the prize, the reward. And they're like, man, like, I thought it was important when I was on earth, and now I see just how much more important this is. Amen. And so all month, church, we have been learning from 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 16 through 39, and you know, King Ahab goes out to meet the prophet of God, the only one left, Elijah, and they decide, hey, we want to see once and for all who the one true God is. And so they have this competition, and we've learned right over and over again now that Baal, the other god, Baal bailed, right? Like, he never showed up. Our God, the one true God, showed up in an undoubtable way. Like, there was no mistaking that our God answered the prayer. And halfway through the day, as these 850 prophets, you know, are trying to get their God to respond, Elijah starts to mock them. He starts to taunt them a little bit. And he says to them, in this sort of string of questions, all sort of mocking, he says, maybe your God is busy. And that word, properly translated from the Hebrew, actually suggests maybe your God is on the toilet. Right? Instead of being in his throne room, he's in the other throne room. That's where your God is. And so we've been reminding ourselves of a couple things, and I want you to keep hearing these. The first is this: the one true God is never too busy for you. He's never too busy. And yet we wonder, right, Rob, if that's really true, if it's really true, why can't you and I then hear from him sometimes? Or maybe a lot of the times, or some of us maybe even most of the times, right? Especially at times like Christmas, when God is obviously speaking loud and clear. Why can't we hear? Well, the answer's obvious, right? Because when God speaks louder, you and I, we get noisier and busier. Our lives have all too much noise, all too much activity. And so we have effectively tuned out God. It's sort of like the text we looked at last week, right? Just like there was no guest room available for Mary and Joseph as Mary is on the verge of having Jesus, like, right now. In the same way, for many of us, even though we really want God to be a part of our lives, we've just gotten so busy and we've added so much noise that effectively we've left no room for God in our lives. This is what happens. You know, when God speaks louder, we get noisier and busier. And so we've said, you know, our problem with hearing is not God's busyness, but it's our busyness, right? It's your busyness and my busyness. We are too busy, not God. And so we've been using the toilet, the throne room, as this metaphor to communicate this, right? And so I love our series graphic, right? The throne room, are you making room for the king? And so we talked last week, and these are just fun, right? Like the toilet used to be a place. Most of us are old enough where we can remember back to when the toilet used to be a place where we could get a few minutes of peace and quiet, right? Like where our minds could have like a few minutes of just being idle, right? Like nothing going on up there, so that we actually had some space to listen and to hear. But we discovered that now 3 out of 4 Americans admit that they bring these things to the toilet, right? 75%. And it's getting worse. With each passing generation, the percentage is higher and higher and higher and higher. Once we're all gone, like it's just almost going to be game over unless something changes, right? And we learned, crazy, that cell phones are 10 times dirtier than toilet seats. Right? Like, would you ever think, unless like you were in a really bad spot and had made a lot of really bad decisions over and over again the night before, would you ever really think of putting your cheek down on the edge of the toilet seat? No, you wouldn't. But we hold this sucker up to our face all the time, even though it's 10 times dirtier, 10 times more bacteria. And if you don't believe that this is a problem, right? People like, oh, that many people can't take their phone. You know what? Every year, this is an actual statistic, every year, 7 million people drop their phones accidentally in the toilet. After I said that for the first time last week, after both gatherings, I had people say, oh yeah, I've done that. Oh yeah, I've done that. So like, you know, some of you might go, oh no, like, but yes, some of you have done that. That's why when new phones come out with higher levels of waterproofness, you're like, yes, right? Like, I don't have to keep that bag of rice anymore or whatever it is you do. And I think for many of us, like we're so addicted to these things that if we were actually in the very throne room of heaven with God right in front of us and this thing went off, we would say, hang on just a second, just to see. Like we're literally that addicted. So today I want to answer the question, what do we do about that? Like, what do we do about this noise and this busyness and all the things that we become addicted to that add noise and busyness that really keep us from hearing from God? Because just feeling bad doesn't solve anything, right? Oh, I feel so bad. You're right. I'm so busy. I don't hear from God. I'll come back for the next week. For Christmas and for next weekend to feel bad 2 more times, and then hopefully we can start a new series where I don't feel as bad because I'm too busy and I don't hear from God, right? Like that's sometimes how we think. No. Like what can we do about this? And so to get us into today, I want to show you, I found this meme and I put a little picture with it. So let me show you this. I love this. The most terrifying moment in life is when the toilet refuses to flush at someone else's house. Has this ever happened to anyone here? I'm putting my hand up because this has happened to me. Okay, so this has happened. And, you know, here's the thing. Like, does anybody else, like, just sort of, because if this has happened to you, you will feel this way? Do you just have this, like, sort of across-the-board hatred for people who don't keep plungers in literally every one of their bathrooms? Because if you, like, the toilet is clogged and you just did that and you're like, okay, I gotta, and there's, like, no plunger, like, what do you do then, right? And I would really like to have each of you who have had this happen tell me what you did, but I'm worried that if I asked and let you talk out loud, there would be, like, horrific stories we wouldn't be able to recover from. So come tell me afterwards how you fixed this problem, because very few of us have like the courage to crack the door and yell out, hey, I'm having problems in here. Do you have a plunger somewhere? Right? Like, we just don't do that. But I would like to know what you did. And so today, I want to talk to us about clog cures. Right? How do we cure clogs? Now, in the last house that we lived in, the place that always got clogged, it was our sink drains and it was our shower drain. And it's because two of the four members of my household have long, thick hair, right? And that stuff it just clogs things. It was amazing. Like, so anybody ever have that experience where you finally, like, you're fishing around in the sink and it seems like you pull like 8 miles of hair out of there? Just me, right? And so at that house, you know, like, you'd go to some place like your, you know, under your sink, and you'd open that sucker up, and you know, you'd have something like this, right? This would be one clog cure, some liquid plumber, some Drano Max, and you'd follow the instructions. You probably put like twice as much down there as it calls for, leave it a little bit longer, pray like crazy, and then, like, you know, you run the hot water and hopefully that gets things out. At our current house, we haven't, like, maybe the main shower a little bit, but we really haven't had the same level of problems with sink drains and with the shower. But for some reason in this house, if you use more than like a quarter sheet of toilet paper, it like wants to clog, right? And so for most people, right, like for most of us, right beside our toilet, we have one of these suckers, right? No? Okay. If you don't, you need one. And I kind of like this one because, especially if it happens a lot, like this one has like a nice, flat, smooth top. If you have to like plunge aggressively and it's like just a stick that like pokes into your hand, that can be quite painful if it doesn't quickly cure the clog, right? So this is another clog cure that we own and that we have used and we use quite a bit. Now, this last year, and it wasn't like I know all the details because this wasn't like a family member, this was me, right? I was using this, and there wasn't even that much in there, and I flushed it, and as happens often, it didn't make it through the little thing, the trap, all that stuff, right? So I took my plunger, and I plunged, and I plunged, and I plunged, and before I knew it, literally, like, there was water all around the floor, like, it looked like I was, like, a seaman, right, like, on a ship, and we'd just been through, like, a monsoon. I mean, it was bad. And so, like, I prayed, and I waited, and I plunged. I literally plunged for days. And I knew, there's, like, 8 sheets of toilet paper in there. Like, how did that do that, right? And so I was on the verge of calling a plumber, which is, most of you were like, yeah, like, that's what we would have done right away. But I discovered a new thing, a new clog cure. It's this thing. I think, and just like to let you know, it was like 17, 18 bucks at Modern Home. And this thing not only is amazing, but we had an issue here at the church down in the basement in the kids area, and I brought it over here and it worked perfect too. So here, like, watch this. This is kind of cool. So this sucker goes in your toilet and it has this nice rubber piece so it doesn't scratch anything up. And then that thing, you know, pushes through the trap and you can turn it and you pull it out and it has literally worked 100% of the time. This thing is a miracle worker, right? I just wanted to let you guys know, I'm going to put this is kind of a dangerous thing, but I'm going to set that clog cure right there. So I think it's called a toilet snake, maybe. But who knows? It's actually the $17 thing the plumber brings over when he charges you a $75 service fee, and he goes, zhit, zhit, and he like leaves, and you scratch him a check, and you feel like an idiot because you didn't go buy one of those. So this was like a new contraption I got. Like, nothing worked. It's sort of like what the Bible says, right? Like sometimes in life there's the easy solution, but the scriptures say some things only happen by prayer and fasting, right? Like, sometimes it can just be like business as usual. We can do some smarter things, some wise things, and everything works out. Other times things don't move, and we as people of faith got to kick it into high gear. We got to fast. We got to pray. Sometimes it requires that. Now, that's all I'm going to say about sinks and toilets today. No more sinks, no more toilets. Some of you, was that not fun? Did you guys not enjoy that? What I really want to talk about is how we can effectively unclog our lines of communication with God. Because that's the point, right? For some of us, it feels like those things are clogged, kind of like the worst clog we've ever had, and we just don't know how to get rid of the clog, how to break through. And so we're going to talk about that, because here's the truth. It's not like we can just quit everything, right? I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to quit everything. I'm going to not be involved in anything. And I'm just going to go sit in a tower somewhere like a monk and do nothing but listen for God. For most of us, we don't have that option. And so I just want you to hear just these few words from this super familiar Old Testament verse. It comes from Psalm 46. And I think that this has a lot of power that will help us, and we can remember it. So it'll be something we can take with us and live out. So here it is. Psalm 46:10 says this: "Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God." So much clog curing power in this simple verse, in those few words. And I'm wondering if you don't already, if even right now during this gathering, I don't care if you're in the room or if you're watching online, doesn't matter. I'm wondering if we could commit that to memory. It's just a few words, right? Be still and know that I am God. Psalm 46:10, right? Like, I just over, and you're going to see it on the screen a number of times. So it's just an opportunity for you to really focus on it, to think about it, to say those words. Be still. See, I'm not even reading it off my iPad. Be still and know that I am God. It's really easy, right? Psalm. See, you guys already mostly have it. It's so good, right? Commit it to memory and hide it in your heart, not just your mind, right? Don't just have it so you can like, I kind of know it in my head. No. Like, I want you to have some feeling and emotion with this as well, because when it's hidden in our hearts, it has much a higher chance of pumping its way out to our hands and to our feet, right? A lot of stuff stays in our head and just does nothing. And that's not the point at all. So here we go. I want to look at this and just take it piece by piece. Ready? Be still and know that I am God. So we're going to focus on be still to start. So be still means to be weak. It means to be so weak that we actually fall limp. It means to leave things alone. It means to abandon. It means to withdraw. It can be translated to be lazy. No. Like, sometimes it needs to be like we're just lazy instead of running around like chickens with our heads cut off. We got to be still. Other ways to think about this, maybe a little bit more modern, right? Stop talking. Switch off the phone. To stop commenting. To actually listen. To stop arguing. To stop questioning. To stop moaning. Right? Did you notice, like, except for the listen part, all of those were stopping something, right? They were all about stops. And so clog cure number one under this idea of being still is this. We should remove the internal and external movement from your life, right? Remove the internal and external movement from your life. Sometimes, if people look at you and they look at me, it can appear like we've slowed down a little bit physically, right? Like we just, hey, they're sitting somewhere. They're not running around doing everything everywhere all the time. Like it appears like that's happening physically. But do you ever have that happen where physically you have turned off the busyness and noise, but mentally it's just as noisy and just as busy? You're thinking about a million things. Your mind isn't quiet like ever. It's crazy, right? Now, I want us to continue to think about like our technology metaphor. Yeah, you know, blue light keeps us from sleeping. And so everybody recommends like no blue light, no phone screen, no tablet screen, no computer screen, no TV screen, 2 to 3 hours before you want to sleep. Like none, right? That's the recommendation if we actually want to be healthy, well-rested people. I know, is anybody else feeling a little bit conviction from just that little stat right there, right? And yet, we keep these devices where? Right beside our beds. We do, right beside our beds. And we use them, I know, like the two of you who don't, like just knock it off. We use them like right up until bedtime. And then if we like can't fall asleep in, I don't know, like 2.3 minutes, what do? We're like, well, I can't sleep. So we grab these things and we scroll or we play, right? Like that'll work. Like let's like pump more blue light in through our eyes to our brains and like maybe that'll help us fall asleep better. I mean, at some point you just well of exhaustion, but it's not having your phone there helped, right? It's not reading those 27 extra Facebook posts actually help. So we do that, right? So one thing I do, because I actually have this right beside my bed, just like you guys too, so I'm not going to like tell you this. So I want to give you what I think is the second best thing to do, which is what I do. I put this, it's actually on this right now. I put my phone every night on do not disturb mode. So if you try to call me, it won't come through. If there's a Facebook message or an email, it doesn't light up. Nothing notifies me. It's on do not disturb mode. And I leave it on do not disturb mode until I am ready to hear from and or talk to people, which a lot of times is not until the next day and usually afternoon. Because here's what I've discovered, and this is true. I try to do this in so many areas of my life. If I'm with my family, if I'm going out with Bethany, you know, like sometimes you can't help but have to bring these things. But man, if you can have them for emergencies legitimately and not like use them and have them on a mode that aren't constantly buzzing and notifying you, I think that's better. And here's what I've experienced by doing that. I actually have less noise in my head. I have more freedom to think and to pray and to create, because I'm not thinking about everybody else needing me. And I get it, right? Like, we live in a world now, it's weird. I mentioned this a couple weeks ago, you know, it's like, when I was a kid and somebody called you, they called your house and they left a message on the answering machine, and there was absolutely no expectation that you were going to get a call back anytime soon, right? And now we live in a world where someone's like, I left a voicemail or I sent a text like 8 minutes ago. How come they haven't responded yet? Well, I just want you to know, for me, for my health, so that I can better serve you, likely my phone's on do not disturb mode and you ain't getting through. Amen. Okay, so that's the second best way. Here is, I think, the best way. There should be times where we turn these things off, where we leave them in a different room, where we just don't take them with us. That would be the best option. Now, I get it. You know what everybody says when you tell them, hey, just like leave this in another room, or at nighttime, just turn it off. Like, just turn it off. What does everybody say? I can't because it's my alarm clock. How am I supposed to wake up, Rob, if I don't have my cell phone? So I have a question. Is there anyone in the room today who would actually try this if there was like some mind-blowing invention that would actually help you to wake up in the morning that wasn't your phone? Is there somebody who would legitimately try turning the phone off or leaving it in a different room if you had a way to wake you up? Is there anybody? All right, Rusty, here you go, buddy. You have two? All right, who doesn't have one of these but would try it? Laura, you would do this? No phone in your room? Give it a chance? Okay. Okay, here we go. Over Bethany's head to you. Boom. You know what's crazy? It was hard to find, like, just an alarm clock. Like, I found a bunch that were, like, $50 to $100 that you could plug in and charge your phone on. And I'm like, that defeats the purpose of not having your phone right beside the bed, right? So that's just, like, a basic, cheapy alarm clock that you can plug in. It will wake you up. And you can not have to have this right beside you all the time. All right, so be still, right? Be still. Then we get to the next part. Be still and know. And know that I am God. And know means to teach, to learn, to know, to acknowledge, to realize, to understand. Like, we actually gain understanding. So to stop, and other things, to stop doubting, to be sure, to have faith, to get no second opinion. That's so good, right? Because here's what we do a lot of the times. We know something, right? Like, we just know. Like, God has told us, we know. And then we can't help ourselves. We start talking to everybody else and getting other opinions and doing more research. And then all of a sudden, we start second-guessing what we knew. Right? We're not told to talk to everybody and get everyone's opinion and to weigh it all out, right? Like, we're told to know certain things. And so clog cure number two under and know is this. Have the faith to paint yourself into a corner. Isn't that good? Some of you were like, no, I don't want to be painted into a corner. But let's think about this just really practically. Can we do that? Do you know that God's word can be trusted? Yeah, okay. We would say yes to that. Do you know that whatever is occupying and making your mind and your life busy is lesser than God? You know this, right? I don't care if it's technology or just something else. Whatever that thing is that you are doing that's making your life noisy and busy, it's less than God. It's not equal with God. It's certainly not greater than God. We know this, right? But let me ask you this. If people actually observed your life, if they observed my life, would they see and know that that was our belief? Right? That we believed the word of God was true. We knew that. And we knew that all the things that add noise and busyness are lesser than God. If people watched how we lived, would they be able to tell that this is what we really know? Or would they see something different? Why not paint yourself into a corner so you have no other choice but to live what you say and believe? Right? Like, just do it. I don't care what it is. It could be turn it off at night. It could be Turn it off in the bathroom. Never even bring it into the bathroom. It could be this. Turn it off when you are with actual real life people. Right? Like, tell me this does not drive you crazy when you are actually like with other humans and they're like, Oh my gosh. Like, it's enough to... So, you know how many accidents happen nowadays because people literally will walk down the streets of even places like New York City not paying any attention because they're all on their phones? No matter what it is, might not be your devices that are the things adding noise or distracting you, whatever it is, turn it off. Be still and know and live what you know. Force yourself, paint yourself into a corner so you have no other choice but to live what you know. And then watch this. Here's the last part. Be still and know that I am God. Right? That I am God. I am the Almighty. I am the one in control. I am your hope. I am your rock. I am your fortress. I am the God that is love. I am the one who is ever present, the ever present help in trouble. I am your Father and your Shepherd, the one who leads, nourishes, protects, and restores. You know, for so many of us, like, we have what has been called limiting beliefs, right? We have these beliefs that limit what we think is possible, what we think we can do, what we think God's going to do for us. Another way to say this is it's a limiting belief, but a lot of times it's a lie, right? It's a lie that we believe. So let's think of what a couple maybe limiting beliefs might be in this area. Here's one. If I don't stay connected to the outside world, I'm going to miss something important. I'm just like, Rob, I get it. I know I want to. It'd be great, but I'm going to miss something. I'm going to miss something super important. And then what am I going to do? There's going to be that emergency call or this thing or that thing or the next thing. Listen, there's a million ways to get a hold of us that don't take very long, right? If it's that important, people will be able to break through. That's a lie. It's a limiting belief. Here's another one. If I'm not always busy, then I'm not worthy, right? I don't feel like I'm earning my keep. So I got to, like, because these people will be happy if I go do this, and those people will be happy if I go do this. And so I got to be here, there, and everywhere. And we just, like, run around and create so much chaos in our lives that no human was ever made to manage. And so what do we do with limiting beliefs, right? We have to combat them with an empowering truth. And let me just give you one I think that works. Being present and connected leads to better results, better outcomes every single time. Being present, seeing people, being connected, talking to, like, nobody ever comes to the end and says, I wish I would have spent a few more hours every week on my device, right? We want more time with people that we know and love. Amen. It's way, way, way more important. And so here's clog gear number three under this heading of that I am God, right? So we're supposed to paint ourselves into a corner, but here's the thing. Make sure it's the right corner. Like, don't just paint yourself into a corner because, oh, Rob said this. So you go home and you're like, woo, 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 woo. Paint yourself and you're like, I'm in a corner. This is a terrible corner. Like, you know, no, that's not the point here. You got to make sure it's the right corner. So here's the thing. The do less, be less busy corner is a good corner. It's better, right? It can be extremely helpful, but it's not the right corner. Like, that's not the ultimate point here. Because remember, there were 850 prophets that Elijah faced that spent all day long crying out, getting louder and louder, even cutting themselves at some point to get a response from their God. They painted themselves into the wrong corner. It wasn't the right God. It wasn't a real God. Nothing happened after the entire day. They could never get his attention. Our God, the one true God, is always the right corner to paint yourself into. I love the passage, James chapter 1, verses 5, I think, through 7 or 8, that talks about, if any of us lacks wisdom, we should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault. So if you lack wisdom, you don't know what to do in an area, the scriptures instruct us to ask God because he wants to give us wisdom generously to everyone, right? But then it goes on and says, but when you ask, you must believe, right? You can't sort of, oh, I ask God, is he going to answer? Because if we doubt, we got to have faith, we got to believe, we got to know, because if we doubt, then we're like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. And the scripture says God doesn't give anything to people like that. We got to paint ourselves into the right corner. We got to paint ourselves into God's corner. See, a good thing, a good step for us to take, a good thing to do would be to be less busy. A better thing for us to do would be to force ourselves, paint ourselves into a corner, to force ourselves to do better. Every one of us, most of the time, takes the easy path, right? We take the path of least resistance. And so we got to paint ourselves into a corner to force ourselves to do better. But the best thing we can do if we really want to cure these communication clogs in our lives is to fully rely on God. This is like the prayer and fasting level of curing clogs in our communication. We fully rely on God. I want you to see this in one image altogether. Check this out. I love this. It's just a little thing. It says, be still and know that I am God. Be still. Stop talking. Switch off your phone. Stop commenting. Listen. Stop arguing. Stop questioning. Stop moaning. Be still and know. Stop doubting. Be sure. Have faith. No second opinion. That I am God, the God who is almighty. God is in control. God is love. God is king. God is my hope, rock, fortress. God is ever present, a help in times of trouble. God is my father. God is my shepherd. He will lead me, nourish me, protect me, and restore me. You know what? If you have your phone on you, let's put it back up just for another few seconds. Maybe snap a picture of that. If you can't see it real great, I'm going to share it on my Facebook after the second gathering today. You can go there and save it so you have this all in one place. But I want to give you just one more thing. I want you to see the full verse with me because it's important. And most people, if you know Psalm 46:10, you just know, be still and know that I am God. But let me show you the rest. It's really cool. Here we go. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted among the earth. To exalt means to lift up or to raise. And I wonder, for you and I, what do we elevate? What do we lift up? What do we raise in terms of our belief? Oh, I really believe this. This is important. I know this is true. And what do we lift up? What do we raise? What do we elevate in terms of how we live? And are those things the same? I see this all the time with us people of faith. Oh, I really believe this. And that thing we say, that thing we're passionate about, never makes its way into our lives. No wonder when we live like that people far from God want nothing to do with him, right? We got to fix that. That doesn't work. It's got to be both. We got to elevate things in terms of what we know and believe and how we live them. And maybe more importantly, this question. What kind of God is exalted everywhere, right? In among the nations and in the earth. What kind of God is exalted everywhere? I want to just read the few verses of this psalm, Psalm 46, over you, because I think it'll help us think about who our God is. Our God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, Though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is with her. She will not fail. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see that what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the earth. I will be exalted among the nations." Do you feel that? Out of all that chaos, God is saying to his people, "Be still. Just be still and know that I'm God. And in that, I'm going to be exalted among the nations and the earth." The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Listen, church, your God, the one true God who always listens and always responds, this is who he is. So trustworthy. You only exalt a God who follows through, who delivers, who answers, who responds. So a question. Let's look at our series graphic one last time. This throne room graphic, those words are so powerful. Are you making room for the king? See, most of us, I know some aren't, but for many of us, we are on these things far too much. And here's what I wonder. I'm not going to ask you to, you know, hey, we're going to put baskets up here. Come, you know, put your devices on the altar and give them to Jesus. No, it's not the point. But this is more risky. It's going to be more painful. Would you have an honest conversation? Maybe today'd probably be better, right? So that we don't forget about it and move on. Have an honest conversation with people who know you, your kids, your spouse, a close friend. Because here's the thing, for most of us, we're on these more than we should be, but if you think that, yeah, I'm probably a little bit worse than I should be, I almost guarantee we are worse than we think we are. Okay? This is why we need to ask somebody who sees us and knows us, and we need to give them permission to be honest and say, hey, How much am I on this? Am I on it way more than I think? Am I on it way too much? And listen to what they say and take it into account. And listen, if it's not tech, what is it for you? What is that thing that adds so much noise and busyness to your life so that you can't be still? Is it that you're a workaholic? Are you a hobbyaholic, right? You have all these hobbies and you love them and they take all your time. Maybe for some of us, it could be something like anxiety, right? That just pushes us to be busy in a way that isn't sustainable. As we end today, we're actually going to hear the band play a song over us and we're going to do a couple other songs too. So we have some moments to really process this question. What is it, that thing, and what are we going to do about it? Listen, if you want to remove the clog in your communication with God, and you want to access his very throne room, the throne room of heaven, consistently, listen, you got to still your life inside and out. You got to focus on what you know to be true, and you've got to fully rely on God. And so Jesus, today, I get it, for some of us, we just need a little bit of routine maintenance. Maybe we just need to add a little bit of stillness, a little bit of space, and you'll speak to us, because we're pretty good other than that. For others of us, we have these near impossible clogs. We've poured in drain cleaner, we've been plunging all month. We still haven't broken through. We need some fancy tool. We need some extra effort. We need some prayer and fasting. We need to just paint ourselves into a corner, Jesus, and we need to fully rely on you. Help us to break through and to reach you in the very throne room of heaven today, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.